What if I told you that with a simple change, you could run your DC motors much more efficiently, using less current and with more stable control? Well, I've written a motor library that does exactly that. And in today's video, I'd love to show you how it works and back it up with a couple of simple tests that prove just how good it really is. Welcome to More Little Man Builds. We're on another ESP32 programming adventure, and today we're going to delve into Espressif's motor control pulse width modulation peripheral. Now, it's hardware based, built specifically for motors, and you're going to watch it blow LEDC out of the water. So we're going to split this video into two parts. Firstly, the testing, which will hopefully show just how good MCPWM really is. And secondly, how we can include the libraries both in the Arduino and PlatformIO, but most importantly, put it within our RTOS framework and continue our project development. Let's crack on. Let's take a quick look at our hardware setup. Firstly, we've got our buck converter with an input voltage of 20 volts and an output voltage of 6 volts or 7 amps. If you need more information on how to set up the buck converter, please check out this video showing above. It's then connected to our IBT2 or BTS7960 motor driver, which of course is connected to our DC motor. It shares a common ground with the ESP32 and also is connected via pins 37, 38 for both left and right PWM signals, and both enable lines are tied to pin 39. So here's what our hardware setup looks in real life: our buck converter, driver, motor, and ESP32 controller. So let's take a look at our sweep sketch, which is an LEDC versus MCPWM comparison. Now, apologies, the video is slightly delayed from the serial monitor, but what it should show is that at 18% LEDC started, and the pulse width modulation will continue to work until 15% on the way back down. And the reason for this is LEDC is single-ended, it's edge-aligned and pretty coarse at 20 kilohertz, so the motor sees a less effective average voltage and rougher torque. Whereas MCPWM, on the other hand, it's going to start sooner. So it starts at 15%, again, video being a little delayed, sorry. And the reason for this is MCPWM is center aligned, it's complementary with cleaner timing, so it delivers more usable torque per percent and keeps turning further down the sweep. So it's going to continue all the way down to 11% and keep turning even at this low PWM value. This is a really cool reason why MCPWM is much better than LEDC. So here's the rotation demo. So when I was setting this up, I ran the sketch 4 times continuously and filmed over the entirety. And here you can see each of the LEDC sequences running at pulse width modulation of 20% duty and how they are staying relatively in sequence. And at the end of the video, you'll see it pause there. So not too bad. And at these low PWM duties, it's still pretty good. Here we've got the MCPWM comparison. So it seems to be relatively decent in terms of holding the consistency across each of the cycle, each of the turning cycles. I have to admit that there's nothing perfect, and perhaps if I'd filmed for longer, I would have got a better average, but they're pretty close. Here is where it really started to show the difference between LEDC and the MCPWM. You can clearly see that they're already going out of sequence and it just gets worse and worse. So if you're running a motor with LEDC, you're just not going to get the same kind of consistency. So you'll see here as the video pauses at the end, they're vastly out of sync versus the MCPWM at 75% duty. Now, you can't quite run a clock to it, but I would suggest that it's doing much better than with LEDC. And so in summary, you can run a motor off the LEDC library, no problem. But I would argue that you should definitely upgrade to the motor control pulse width modulation if you have the chance. Look at that. They're pretty damn good. So there's one final outcome of the rotation test, and that is when we directly compare each of the LEDC versus MCPWM tests against each other. And here it's clear. At the same duty cycle, MCPWM just makes better use of each volt and each percent of the pulse width modulation time. Less is lost in the diodes, the waveform is smoother, and the motor ends up with much more effective torque, so it spins faster by comparison. There you can clearly see the outcome. Now, I also did write a temperature sketch, and I was expecting that LEDC would run hotter, but unfortunately I couldn't prove this to be true, at least with my tests at the moment. So for this video, I've just included the rotation and the sweep test. However, you can find all three scripts up on our Little Man Builds GitHub page, and feel free to check them out in more detail. Let's just cover off how we use the motor library in the Arduino IDE. So again, we go to the library manager, and in here we can type ESP32 MCPWM. And you can hit this one by Little Man Builds. You can hit install. It will tell you that it successfully installed the library. Also here, there are some examples. So you might want to look at the different types of braking patterns or some more of the advanced features that are available within the library, or even two motors, so it's just up to you. In this case, I'll select the braking overview, and there's the full code ready for you to review. And of course, everything's available on the Little Man Builds GitHub page, so feel free to scroll through all the documentation that's there as well. Let's now get our MCPWM library working within the RTOS framework. Now for today, we need to change these debugging macros, because at some point we will use floating points, and at the moment these only handle integers. So rather than explain it, we're going to do a copy paste. And now that we're using templates, these can be overloads for floating point precision. So we need to get our MCPWM library running within our RTOS configuration. So of course there are some configuration variables that we need to introduce. So let's add a section for this. So we can call it namespace motor. And we can have some constant expressions. So we have our right pulse width modulation pin, which I will be using pin 37 on my ESP32S3. We have our left pulse width modulation pin, which will be pin number 38. And this particular motor driver does have an enable pin, so we can specify this as pin 39. And this is the namespace motor. And this is the namespace config. Now let's head over into PlatformIO. Again, we go down to our libraries. And this time we're searching for ESP32 MCPWM as our library. And we can add it to the project and hit add. Congratulations, it's been added. And now you can see that this library has also been added to our project. So we don't need this anymore, or this, and we don't need our app config. Now that we've added our library, we can use this include statement. We can go down, and we need to add a handler context. Handler context. And now we have our motor set up. First thing, we can declare a motor object and call it drive motor. So now we need to specify the hardware configuration. Let's do that. And we can say that it's equal to our right pulse width modulation pin. So we're just accessing the variables that we created earlier from our app config file. So this time it's the left pulse width modulation pin, and that's located within config motor and left pulse width modulation. And the last one is our enable pin, which is equal to config motor enable pin. We can now say drive motor.setup and give it our hardware configuration. And finally, we pass our handler context, the address of our drive motor. So our RTOS task, instead of passing nothing, we can now pass our handler context. And I forgot the address. So let's go down here. For this particular example, I don't want to see anything else happening. So let's comment these out for now. And we'll do the same thing as our listener RTOS task. We can say auto motor is equal to context motor. We will need some variables. By the way, guys, if you're enjoying this content, please feel free to smash the like button or consider subscribing. It really helps me out with the algorithm. And of course, I'd love for you to join our community. And lastly, we have a direction object, which we will start as clockwise. In this particular case, I'm not going to use the examples that are up on our GitHub page. I will create another one. Let's do ramp up from 0% through to 100%. And we put in our step delay. Next, we would like to hold at max percent instead of step delay. We will say this is our end hold. Now we need to ramp down from 100% to 0%. And let's copy and paste this one. Lastly, we pause at zero, which effectively is a neutral guard. And the reason we're doing a neutral guard is because we're going to reverse the direction of the motor. Let's save that. Let's see if it compiles. Oh, everything was successful. Let's send it over to the ESP32 and check it out. And this is why we needed to change the debugging macro so that we could display the floating point integers, which you can see here. And that sketch works really well, going backwards and forwards. So there's the full overview of our MCPWM library, including its integration into our RTOS framework. If you have any questions or queries, please feel free to leave a comment below, and otherwise jump across to our GitHub page to check out the code. See you next time.